This is our first lecture in electric circuit analysis 2, which is sinusoids and phasors, and this slides and lecture content is based on the chapter number 9 of the book Fundamentals of Electric Circuits by Alexander and Sidico. I am Dr. Mohsin Shehzad from Electrical and Computer Engineering Department of COMSETS University, Islamabad, Zaytabad campus. As per definition, the phasors are actually an easy representation of sinusoids, which is the combination or a complex number representation which contains the information about the amplitude and phase angle of the sinusoids. It was first introduced by Charles Steinmetz in 1893. So starting with the division of complex numbers, a complex number that can be written in three different ways. For example, the first way is rectangular form, in which it is represented as the sum of real and imaginary part. Real part is usually represented as x and imaginary part is y. And j is the complex number operator, which is equivalent to minus 1 square root. In polar form, we can represent the complex number as r angle phi, where r is the magnitude of the complex number and phi is the angle. Similarly, in exponential form, the complex numbers can be represented as r exponential j phi, where j is again the same complex number operator. Some of the writers call it iota also. And if we convert from one form to another, the complex numbers can easily be converted. For example, if we want to convert from rectangular to polar or exponential form, we can find angle and magnitude as these relationships. For example, r is x square plus y square whole under the root, and phi is tangent inverse of y over x, where y is imaginary part and x is a real part. Similarly, we can convert from polar or exponential forms back to the rectangular form as this. X, the real part, is r times cos of phi, whereas the imaginary part y is equal to r times sine of phi. So, in general, we can write that is equal to x plus jy is equal to r angle phi, or is equal to r times cos of phi plus j sine of phi. Putting these values, we can get this relationship. In the transient coordinates, we can write it. For example, if we mention the real and imaginary axis, then x is the real axis, y is the imaginary axis. So the magnitude of x is this one, and y is along y-axis. R would be the magnitude of resultant vector and at an angle of phi. So in this way we can represent the complex numbers. It is convenient for us to use the rectangular form for addition and subtraction of the complex number, whereas for multiplication and division we prefer polar form. This is not compulsory, but it is a matter of convenience, so we can use any other form of representation for any operation. However, the ease and convenience would be in addition and subtraction in the form in rectangular form, and in multiplying and dividing we prefer to use polar forms due to convenience of operation. For example, the addition, if we add two complex numbers z1 and z2, x1 plus x2 are the real parts of both numbers. These are added together, and y1 and y2 are the imaginary parts, and these are added together. So the resulting complex number would have also a single real and single imaginary part. Same operation can be done for the subtraction. For multiplication and division, we prefer the polar form. The magnitudes are multiplied together of both of the complex numbers, and their angles are added. Whereas in division, the phase angles are subtracted and their magnitudes are divided as in the base case. Reciprocal is a special case of division. So one can be represented as 1 angle 0, and if it's 1 angle 0 divided by r angle phi, then we can simplify it like this, 0 minus phi, the result would be minus phi. And 1 upon j is minus j. This is a general identity from our previous concepts. Source square root can be calculated like this one, square root of a complex number z. So we need to get the square root of the magnitude, and the phase angle would be halved. Complex conjugate is of a complex number is also a complex number with opposite sign in the imaginary part. So if z is x plus y, then z conjugate would be x minus jy, and its polar form would be r angle minus phi, or exponential form is r angle exponential minus j phi. So phase representation of sinusoid is, we already know about the Euler's identity, which is exponential plus minus j phi is equal to cos of phi plus minus j sine of phi. So this is also a complex number. The Euler's identity is results in a complex number in the form of cos and sine. So if we have positive sign here, then it would be positive here, and if we have negative sign in the exponential, then cos and j sine will also carry negative sign in between them. So this shows that we can regard cos of phi as the real part of this expression, and j sine of phi as the imaginary part of this expression, e power j phi. So it can be mathematically written as cos of phi is capital RE. RE stands for the real part of e power j phi, and sine phi is imaginary part of j phi. So, and as a rule of thumb, we generally use cosine functions to represent the phases instead of sine functions. However, as we know that sine and cosine have just a phase angle difference of 90 degrees, then we can easily use sine to develop phases as well. However, in case of using sine for converting the sinusoid into phasor, we will have to subtract 90 degrees from the phi angle in order to make it equivalent. What I want to say is, for example, considering the waveform, if sinusoid is this one, the cosine function would be like this one, which will have the peak at 0, and this phase angle is 90 degrees. So we must cater for this 90 degree phase angle here. This is what we should take care of. For all the other things, for example, its function of time is voltage. So as a matter of convention, we use cosine function, but we can also use sine functions. However, we must consider this 90 degree phase difference when using sine function as the source for phasor development. The phasor representation of sinusoids is simple as, for sinusoid, VFT is, for example, Vm cos omega t plus phi. This phi is the phase angle. It can be anything, 0, minus 10, minus 20, minus 100, plus 100, whatsoever. So it can be anything in between minus 360 to plus 360 or even more. So when we convert, we see this part from previous slide, the Euler's identity, it is the real part of e power j sin j phi. So VFT is treated as this, cos omega t plus phi is treated as real part of e power j omega t plus phi. And as Vm is constant, we can take it inside of the bracket or outside of the bracket, it doesn't matter a lot. VFT is a real of Vm e power j phi plus e power j omega t. This is just splitting of this exponential term. this whole part, which is not a function of time, this is constant. Vm is a magnitude of the vector vft, so it is constant. Phi is just a constant angle, so we can calculate it. So this is a complex constant number. This whole term is actually called the phasor, and it is the magnitude and phase angle. That is why it's called phasor. Whereas the term, whole of this term, is called sinor. We are going to see it on next slide as well. This is called sinor. Sinor is actually the function of time, and we can term it as a rotating phasor as well. So if vft is a real part of vm e power j phi into e power j omega t, and this blue encircled part can be said as the phasor, and e power j omega t comes along it. So we must consider or remember that this part is always there. It's important and we should not forget about it. So this quantity Vm e power j phi is usually represented in block letter, bold letter, block letter. It's capital letter in bold form, and it is called phasor. Phasor V is the phasor representation of sinusoids of Vft. That is complex representation of magnitude and phase. Its magnitude and its phase are represented as a complex number. So, and we can consider this phasor like this one. This vector is our phasor quantity. It has some magnitude of Vm and it has a phase angle of phi. However, when we see the actual sinusoid which was given here, it is function of time. It is not constant, it is always changing, and it's always changing its angle. Omega t is corresponding to angle. So the sinor, which the term which I introduced on the last slide as well, if we treat it as a phasor, then it would be a constant at same position, at of same magnitude. But if we see the actual sinusoid, it is not constant, it is function of time, so, and with constant amplitude. Its amplitude is Vm, so it would be rotating in counterclockwise direction in this circle as the time passes. So with the passage of time, this Vm would be rotating in this circle, and this phi angle would be changing. But actually the phi is constant. The total angle of the sinusoid would be changed, which is omega t plus phi. So due to increase in t, whole angle would change, and it will be treated as this rotating phasor. So rotating phasor is actually a sinor. So consider the plot of sinor. This is the term sinor for this whole thing. It is not only for this. This is phasor, and this whole thing is sinor. So when we represent it in complex plane, a real and imaginary axis, the positive direction is its counterclockwise direction. Angular velocity is omega radian per second. It's rotating at omega radians per second. So this rotating phasor is called sinor, and it would rotate. We can take its projection on the linear axis, its circular axis and its linear axis, as a function of time. If we try to represent it, we can represent it like this one. V of t may be regarded as the projection of the sinor e power v e j omega t on the real axis. Please note this difference. Phasor is only V. Block and bold V is phasor, whereas block and bold V multiplied with e power j omega t is sinor, and it's rotating phasor. So phasor representation of sinusoids. Next, we are going to see the value of sinor at time t is equal to 0 is the phasor V of the sinusoid. For example, on previous slide, if we put t is equal to 0, this whole number would result into 1. E raised to the power 0 is 1. Then sinor would be equal to the phasor. So this is what it's saying. The sinus may be regarded as the rotating phasor. Whenever a sinusoid is represented as phasor, the term EJ omega T is implicitly present. This means that we never say that the phasor is, or sinusoid is, when represented as phasor, is just a constant. We never say about that. I would repeat this point, that whenever we represent a sinusoid as a phasor, it does not mean that we are converting a time varying quantity into a constant quantity, because sinusoid is a time varying quantity due to J omega T part of its angle, but the phasor is a constant quantity which only carries the magnitude and the phase angle phi. It's not a function of time. So if we say that we have represented a sinusoid as a phasor, it implicitly means that this term e power j omega t is already present along with this phasor capital block V. If it is not implicitly present there, then it's incorrect, because phasor V is constant, whereas sinusoid is time varying quantity. So, and but as it is understood, so we do not write it all of the time. E power j omega t term is not always written along with the phasor of some given sinusoid. It's understood that it's already present there. So, and second important point to keep in mind is that, for example, we are adding, subtracting, multiplying, dividing, or whatever operation we are doing on the phasors, all the phasors must be operating at the similar frequency. If their frequency is different, then at any time after the specific time, their phase angle would be different. For example, this is one phasor, and this is one sinusoid, and there is another sinusoid like this one, which has a different frequency. So at any time, we can see that the phase angle here is zero. At this point, both are in same in phase, but here the phase difference of this much appears. So this means phase difference is the difference between the angle of same time. If it's starting to the positive cycle, so the next positive cycle would start from here. However, its positive cycle has started here. So the difference between the starting point of the waveform is phase angle, very simply speaking. So here it was zero, and here it is more than 180. So in this way, if the frequency of the given sinusoids are not similar, then we cannot perform phasor operations for them. It is very important, and it must be kept very clear in mind. It is therefore important when dealing with the phasor to keep in mind the frequency omega of the phasor. Otherwise, we can make serious mistakes. So frequency must be constant, similar for all the phasors on which we are doing some operation. Phasor representation of sinusoid V of T is represented as a real part of V e j omega t. States that to obtain the sinusoid corresponding to the given phasor, multiply the phasor by the time factor and take the real part. We are multiplying with the time factor. This is time factor, and then taking the real part would result in, because the real part of this whole expression would be Vm e power j phi, which is due to this one, into e power j omega t. This is equal to Vm e power j times omega t plus phi. So, and then if we use the Euler's identity, this would be Vm cos of omega t plus phi plus j times sine of same angle omega t plus phi here also. So if we take the real part, it is exactly V of t. As a complex quantity, the phasor may be expressed in rectangular form, polar form, exponential form, because it's complex number, so it can be represented as any of the forms in which the complex numbers can be represented. Since a phasor has magnitude and phase direction, it behaves as the vector and printed in boldface, as I mentioned already. So we can represent phasor as Vm angle phi, and if Im angle minus phi, angle can be positive, negative, or any magnitude. And we can represent it graphically in the form, in phasor form. This is, for example, V, and this is I, from same things, same equations, phasor, its magnitude of the phasor, and its phase angle. We take counterclockwise as positive angle and anti-clockwise as negative angles. So it's positive and negative Im, right? So, and if you see this figure, our positive direction is like this one. So in this direction, which one is ahead is actually leading. So in this diagram, we can say voltage is leading Im by angle phi plus theta. And we can also say current Im is lagging the voltage V by an angle phi plus theta. Why I am using plus? Because it is negative in direction. So total angle would be addition of both these angles. This is in counterclockwise direction and this is in clockwise direction. So in actually we have to subtract it, and there is one minus with this angle. So minus times minus phi minus minus theta could be phi plus theta. So in this way we can say that the angle phase difference between V and I is phi plus theta, and voltage is leading, current is lagging in this case. So the summary, we get to get the phasor corresponding to the sinusoid, the steps are to represent the given sine function, the cosine function, as the real end part of the complex number using the Euler's identity. Then we take time factor out, and then whatever is left, that is the magnitude and exponential of the phase angle phi, would be treated as the phasor. By suppressing time factor, we transform sinusoid from time domain to the phasor domain. So in time domain, it was varying quantity. Phasor is actually the constant. E power j omega t is implicitly present there. So what we have done by converting sinusoid into phasor, we have converted it from time domain to the phasor domain. I have already talked about the time function of time and the frequency dependence of frequency of the phasor. So if the phasor, if frequency is not similar, though we cannot do operation in the phasor with the phasors. So it is important that we have to consider same frequency, and the phasors are actually the frequency domain or phasor domain, and we can simply represent them like this one. It has time function, so it's time domain representation. There is this term present, but we are not considering it. It is only the frequency of phasor domain representation. To get the phasor representation of sinusoid, we express it in the form of cosine function and then take magnitude and phase angle. Whatever is other than omega t is phase angle. For example, if it can be written as omega t plus phi plus theta plus 20. So all this portion would be written here. Secondly, for cosine, it's directly like this one, and for sine, it's minus 90, as I mentioned earlier on previous slides. For cosine, it's theta, and for sine, it's minus 90 along with theta also. The frequency or time factor e power j omega t is suppressed, and the frequency is not explicitly shown in the phasor domain representation because omega is constant. This is, I have talked enough about it, so it should be very clear. However, the response depends upon omega. Omega is not explicitly present, but the response depends upon omega. We cannot operate without omega. And in fact, without keeping omega similar for all the phases in that specific operation, addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, or whatsoever. For this reason, the phasor domain is also known as frequency domain. So we cannot operate without frequency in phasor domain, so it's also called frequency domain. With this, I close today's lecture, and hopefully we will be having another lecture by tomorrow. Thank you.